the city, back of my neck getting dirt and gritty. Bend down, isn't it a pity? Doesn't seem to be a shadow in the city. All around, people looking half dead, walking on the sidewalk harder than a match here. But at night it's a different world. Go out and find a girl. Come on and dance all night. Despite the heat, it'll be alright. And babe, don't you know it's a pity the days can't be like the nights in the summer, in the city, in the summer, in the city.
I've made a couple of videos about anime girls in the past, and it just so happens that because of this reputation, every now and then someone leaves a comment asking the same repetitive question. Where's the Nichijou review? You like all this gay shit, so surely you must have an undying love for the greatest thing since canned bread. Just make the fucking video already, man. Come on, hurry up, where is it? Okay, you wanna hear what I think of Niche Joe? Well, fine, I'll tell you. It's great. Do I need anything else? Everyone and their grandma's labradoodle have given their thoughts on Nickel Jew. There's nothing left for me to contribute. Everybody loves it. Many people have called it the greatest slice of life of all time. They're wrong, of course, but it's a definite contender. The manga is one of the finest pieces of humorous literature of our generation, utilizing surrealism and varied cartooning formats to produce an absurdist breakdown of both the monotonous struggle of our own daily lives as well as the foundations of the slice of life genre itself. Yuko is my wife! And who bestowed this work of art to the undeserving masses all the way back in the fabled year of 2006? Why, it was none other than mystery man Keiichi Arawi. He looks like this.
Konnichiwa.
After the end of Nichijou in 2015, only for it to come back 6 years later, Arawi fell into a creative dry spell for a few months until his attention was captured by the sounds of the city. These sounds perturbed his brain for weeks until finally he did as any artist would do and poured his thoughts out onto paper. And what he concocted would go on to be published as his next major serialization. City. Spelled in all caps for emphasis. Now, let me pause there for a moment and ask you a question. How many mangaka can you think of that managed to successfully follow up a popular, widely beloved series with a brand new manga yet to prove itself? It's not impossible, but it's certainly not common. Striking gold once takes luck, but striking it twice takes genuine talent. Lucky for us, however, Keiichi Arawi is talent. Unfortunately, talent doesn't automatically equal success. And while City has/was received warmly by fans and critics from its debut 6 years ago up until its conclusion in 2021, I'm not gonna sugarcoat it when I say that City is not very popular. It doesn't take solid analytical evidence to reach this conclusion. All you have to do is check the obscenely low amount of fan content it's produced compared to its big sister Nichijou. You see that? Not a very big number. Also, it's mostly porn. There's a simple explanation as to why cities remain so under the radar for this long. One series has an anime, and one doesn't. Therefore, I'm certain that the manga's time in the sunshine will one day arrive once Kiwani decides to adapt it as soon as Nichijou's second season is finally completed in 2032.
Yeah, fucking right.
Now, who gives a shit about stuff like rankings? I'm here to tell you in a long-winded video about why this manga's really good. In fact, I might just manage to convince you that it surpasses its predecessor by the time this is over with. If you're still watching and don't care about either series, or don't even know what a manga is, get the fuck out. City is about the life of a broke college student, and her friend, and her neighbor, and grandma, and a chef. And a soccer team, and a police officer, and an artist, and a playwright, and a pop star, and middle schoolers, and octopi, and John Lennon. There's more characters here than in the Chinese alphabet, although none of them are really as important as Fighting Monkey. It makes sense though. A city is a big place, home to a myriad of strange faces. I've visited my share of cities, and I can report firsthand that a metropolis is nothing but a breeding ground for fucking weirdos. And if you're familiar with someone like Keiichi Arawi, you'd know that every character this man creates fits that label. Our protagonist this time around is Midori Nagumo, the physical embodiment of every college student who ever lived. Dirt poor, impolite, blossoming alcoholic, and beats up old people. To call her flawed would be a compliment, and it's honestly difficult at times to actually like her due to just how much of a malicious bitch she can be. She has her share of brief flashes of redemption, however. And if you don't grow to like her, then there's no need to worry, because this is a manga that distributes screen time to everyone. And I do mean everyone. If there's some old bastard who appears in the background of a couple of panels, he gets his own chapter detailing his backstory and profession as a pro chess player. Characterization is done pretty similar to how it was done in Nichijou, but there are some differences now. Before, Arawi was restricted to writing about the daily adventures of high school girls with their petty problems, but now he's graduated and moved on up to college girls and their petty problems.
Aw, hell yeah! Alcohol! Landladies! Butt plugs!
Also, it's now okay to lewd the characters because they're all canonically 18 to 20!
Yeah! Progress!
I'll confess that one minor problem I had with Nichijou was the fact that almost everyone could feel like a stock gag character. The dumb one, the straight man, the quiet troll, the straight robot. It's perfectly acceptable that the characters are played solely for comedic effect. I mean, that's what Nichijou is, pure comedy. I don't believe every manga has to make a concerted effort to flesh out everyone and inject some of that sweet, sweet character development into every single chapter. If it does, I give it bonus points. But as long as it's funny, that's good enough. However, City succeeds in delivering much more humanized personalities with its characters, giving them all long-term goals and balancing out their negative personality traits with positive ones. What helps with this development is the inclusion of actual story arcs in City. Actual narrative storytelling, something that didn't even exist in the realm of possibility for something as episodic as Nichijou. The best instances of characterization, world building, and story come together in the manga's final arc, where several members of the cast run for mayor and everyone either rallies for or against them. It's the ultimate payoff for 13 volumes of developing an entire city's worth of inhabitants, giving everyone their individual spotlight while highlighting each citizen's greatest strength. Including the chaotic hero Nagumo. It takes some genuine skill to weave an entire urban population's worth of characters together in the span of a short slice of life series, but Arawi managed to do it, in spite of how batshit crazy the story could be at times. Well, maybe not too crazy. I'd say City overall feels far more sedated than its predecessor. Sedated meaning less page-by-page mania for the sake of reaction and more, let's calm down a bit and see what this person's up to today. Oh, they killed a bear with a toilet seat. Well, that's fine. We'll just put it next to the goat.
Zapatero. ¿Qué opina usted del gobierno de Zapatero?
I wouldn't call City relaxing, but if the breakneck pace and off-the-wall nature of Nichijou left you slightly overwhelmed or wasn't your cup of tea, then consider City to be Nichijou post-Adderall. Same nonsensical sense of humor, but peaceful enough for you to focus and take it all in. But then you might wonder, is that humor actually worth taking in? Allow me to ask you another question. How do you funny? What goes into making good joke after good joke and not losing steam? Ask a comedy expert this and they'll hit you with the age-old bullshit excuse.
Comedy is subjective.
You know, it's true the things that amuse me might not amuse others, but do we really need to act like the secret to comedy is an unsolvable mystery? You set up a punchline and you deliver it. It either makes logical sense, or it makes no sense whatsoever. Both ways have potential to be funny. Now let's take a look at being funny through manga. You'd think artists would have an easier time eliciting laughter through this medium. Just draw a funny face or two. It won't get old after the 200th time. But wait, it does get old. We've been doing this for half a century. You better be drawing faces no human eyes have ever seen before for it to be funny nowadays. And although I don't doubt Keiichi Arawi has the power to do this, he also has the benefit of knowing how to execute a damn good joke. Ask any Nichijou fan to tell you what kind of humor the series is working with, and they'll likely answer,
lol, so random, WTF.
I'm shitting my pants right now. The comedy juice is just ravaging my colon. It does it well, though, and that surrealist take on slice of life is carried over perfectly to City. Characters say and do things spontaneously, adults are childish and children are clever, reactions are exaggerated, and things like continuity and realism do not apply in any way, shape, or form. In a word, it's anarchy. Beautiful anarchy. Time for another tangent. Let's talk a little about absurdism.
You want me to jerk off your fucking tail? Well, I'm doing it! And you're taking it like a bitch!
Absurdism in comedy is explained pretty easily. Wacky, nonsensical events occur. The punchline is never what you expect it to be because the punchline isn't meant to logically follow the buildup for the joke. By going against our natural perception and expectation of what constitutes as a joke, we're left dumbfounded and possibly confused. And when faced with this mixture of confusion and surprise, we can't help but chuckle. Due to the spontaneous nature, this type of comedy can come off as horrendously unfunny if executed poorly. Nobody likes random for the sake of random. Keiichi Arawi, however, has fine-tuned his use of absurdity and humor to such a fine degree that it's almost ironically become formulaic. You know nothing he sets up will ever resolve itself in the way you rationally expect it to, and you also know that no character is ever allowed to avoid suffering. Their good fortunes will be ripped away and their dreams will be crushed. Except for Wako. Wako gets whatever she wants. The delivery for each joke is timed to a near-perfect measure, and every panel in the span of 10 pages serves as build-up for that final unexpected outcome while also serving as humorous little side gags on their own. Panels isolated by themselves are able to pack in surreal, hilarious imagery, which is mainly due to the extremely eye-pleasing art style that Arawi's been polishing ever since he started Nichijō. Every character is given such a soft, charming design with warm facial expressions to match so that whenever they flip their shit and start flipping each other, it makes the unanticipated action all the more funny. It's like the manga's own self-imposed reality is crumbling before our very eyes, and somehow, we find it hilarious. People might wonder why Arawi chose to use a common city background as the setting for the manga, as if it was the next best thing after an ordinary high school, but I think it may have been the best possible environment to capture both the personalities of the heroes, as well as the surreal escapades they engage in. The concept of a city itself is a bit absurd when you think about it. Just a crowded mass of people crammed into unsanitary living conditions, devoting their lives to monotonous jobs that don't even seem to contribute to their overall happiness. And despite having such a massive concentration of unique individuals in one place, many have attested to finding life in the city to be one of the loneliest experiences one can have. The city in City, however, is nothing like that. It's colorful, both in appearance and in populace, and it's flat out said several times that the location is likely the safest place in the world. It's still got all the hassle and debacles native to any ordinary city, but the way that absurdity is used to transform those negatives into hilarious situations makes the daily struggle seem more fun than it has any right to be. Sometimes when you find yourself in the presence of chaos and unfolding disaster, all you can really do is laugh. It's all ridiculous. I mean, don't go thinking this is a realistic, bitter piece of satire or anything. It's still balls-to-the-wall insanity most of the time. But you'll likely be smiling all the way through just from how much joy you find amidst the madness. It's really easy to make an urban setting look as gritty and disgusting as possible, which probably keeps it in touch with reality. But it's nice to see that same setting given such a warm coat of paint for once. The city has never been more alive. This manga challenges you to avert your eyes for even a moment. Keiichi Arawi possesses one of the most distinctive art styles in the medium. There's never any doubt about where his touch is felt in every corner of his work. This touch has never felt more prevalent than in the cluttered, eye-catching spaces illustrated in City. I've tried to figure out why Arawi's art goes so well together with his comedy, and then I realized what it reminded me of so much in my head. Cartoons. Yeah, the bubbly designs, over-the-top expressions, pratfall after pratfall, slapstick sequences. It's the essence of an old Saturday morning cartoon, or a four-panel comic strip you'd find in a newspaper. Shit, the entire city race arc with all the major characters battling to complete a marathon full of ridiculous obstacles is basically the foot race version of wacky races. And what makes a chapter feel even more special is when Arawi fully embraces the silly, cartoony potential for manga and gets experimental with his illustrations. Every situation is completely ordinary at its core, but it's the creative presentation that breathes such strong life into it. It's how City and Nichijou manage to retain their slice of life label despite going against as many conventions of the genre as possible. Arawi can make any mundane activity into an exciting event with a few simple pen strokes. And in another world, he's probably producing the most ambitious, action-heavy, cock-bulging battle shonen ever made. The spreads are easily the highest achievement for the artwork. Just a dense collection of visual gags, Easter eggs, and cameos. It's like a game of Where's Waldo, but without that skinny, four-eyed motherfucker Waldo. Okay, now that I've praised City's characters, comedy, and art, prepare for some of the best pages ever drawn in a manga. So context. Volume 4 is one long story arc where every major character introduced undergoes a series of shenanigans that results in all of them meeting outside of a mansion belonging to Miss Tanabe. And this crossover culminates in a massive party scene with more detail packed in than some manga pack into an entire volume. It'd be enough to create just one big spread that celebrates the buildup of an entire story arc featuring every character gathering in one location, but Arawi extends the sequence for 4 spreads worth, aka 8 pages. And there's over a dozen individual gags going on that you can follow from page to page, essentially forming one colossal 4-panel strip. It's an incredible display of artistry, and exemplifies just how hilarious Arawi can be with as much as 2 characters in a cramped corner of a page. And instances of exploring the comedic possibilities of manga like this crop up multiple times over the course of the 13 volumes that make up the series. It's not like Arawi just blows a load of genius in one volume and then pumps out half-hearted attempts at humor the rest of the time. There's always a new idea for how to visually emphasize a gag being tried out. And whether it works out or not, doesn't take away from the creativity that's present. If Nichijou was Arawi pushing the tropes of slice of life beyond their limits, City is him playing with the foundations of cartooning itself as much as the medium of manga will allow. I wouldn't call it a revolutionary direction, but it's a breath of fresh air to taste this much flavor in a time when everyone constantly preaches about how manga is dying or some shit. Here's your proof that it's not. So now the usual recommendation roll call. Should you read City? Obviously, if you're a Nichijou fan, there's no reason for you not to give this a read. I mean, how can you even call yourself a fan? If you didn't like Nichijou for reasons pertaining to the pace and comedy, I still think City is worth the try. It's got appeal for a whole range of audiences, from middle schoolers to college students to disillusioned middle-aged parents. Little something for everyone, IGN approved. And if you're not a superior slice of life enjoyer with a high IQ, and my own words aren't enough to go by, then don't read it. Just keep living life weighed down by the shackles of your own self-imposed desolation and misery, never feeling the warm spirit-cleansing power of Yuko or Wako's smile wash over your putrid heart and soul. That's all for now. Have a nice day.